Before commercial aircraft ever took to the sky, the only way to travel across the oceans of the world was aboard ocean liners. In the era of steam, the liners competed for speed records by designing faster engines and more hydrodynamic hulls. For the majority of the time that steam-powered liners ruled the seas, they mainly used a type of engine called a reciprocating engine. Everyone who has seen the movie Titanic likely remembers the amazing scene where James Cameron recreated the massive engines that drove the ship through the waters of the Atlantic. Well, the two engines you see here are reciprocating engines. They are so named because with each downward stroke of the piston, the crankshaft turns and moves the eccentric rods, which then reciprocates the motion by changing the steam intake direction in the cylinder, allowing it to reverse its stroke. This reciprocating arrangement means that as long as steam is provided to the engine, it will keep itself running. As time went on, engineers found ways to get every last ounce of energy potential out of the steam. When steam moves a cylinder, there is still steam pressure remaining that goes to waste as it is expelled. That energy was later recaptured by having the high-pressure cylinder exhaust into a larger, low-pressure cylinder. And this process could be repeated many times. But the more cylinders you pack into an engine, the more precious space you take up on a ship with a very limited amount of space available. Enter the steam turbine engine. The modern steam turbine we know today was invented by Charles Parsons and demonstrated by his famous little ship, the Turbinia. I have a separate video about Turbinia so you can learn more. But turbines have rows of blades on the inside, and when high-pressure steam is blown across the blades, it makes the shaft rotate, much like a pinwheel or windmill. You would be right if you thought that this design could not match the horsepower output of a reciprocating engine. But the genius of it is that turbines can spin incredibly fast. When paired with the right propeller design, the fast-spinning turbines can create a lot of momentum and surpass the horsepower output of a similarly sized reciprocating engine. But this, however, is in the case of a turbine directly connected to the propeller shaft. In 1905, Cunard's RMS Carmania became the first merchant ship to be solely powered by steam turbine technology. While this was a decision to test the feasibility of the turbine on an ocean liner, it, however, was not the deciding factor on whether or not Cunard would use turbines on the new Lusitania and Mauritania. That decision was already made a year before. In order for RMS Mauritania and RMS Lusitania to achieve the minimum 25 knot speed that was demanded by the British government, they would have needed three quadruple expansion five-cylinder reciprocating engines. They would have been enormous. Imagine Titanic's reciprocating engines, but three of them abreast, with an extra cylinder added to their length. This unimaginable amount of machinery is what steered Cunard to finally accept the use of turbines as main engines. On Lusitania and Mauritania, there would be four propeller shafts, with the outer shafts being driven by a high-pressure ahead turbine, and the inner shafts being driven by a low-pressure ahead turbine. And attached to the same inboard propeller shafts would be a high-pressure astern turbine for reversing. Even with all four ahead turbines in use, the steam was used more economically and therefore could result in a ship that could not only surpass its 25 knot speed minimum, but consume less fuel than a ship of equal speed using reciprocating engines. RMS Mauritania produced a combined 70,000 shaft horsepower and could reach speeds up to 29 knots. This amount of power had never before been seen on an ocean liner. When designing the Olympic-class ships, White Star Line had considered using only turbine engines, but they were still a new technology, and quite expensive at that. Not to mention that Lusitania-class ships soon garnered a negative reputation for their vibrations. I have a separate video dedicated to explaining why ships vibrated, so be sure to check that out when you have a chance. White Star Line had decided to use only two reciprocating engines, but the idea came that the exhausted steam still had some potential energy left in it. So, they decided to add a low-pressure turbine to the ship, which ran off of steam exhaust from both reciprocating engines. And if you still weren't convinced by the efficiency of the steam turbine, consider that just one of Olympic's reciprocating engines required 215 psi of steam pressure to generate 15,000 shaft horsepower. But the little turbine, which ran off of 9 psi of exhausted steam, could produce 16,000 shaft horsepower on its own. In later years, engineers found better ways of getting even more power output from steam turbines. You see, as the turbine spins, it not only generates speed, but that speed also creates greater momentum. The problem with Mauritania's engines was that the speed of the turbine was limited to the amount of resistance of both the weight of the propeller shaft and the drag of the water around the propellers. By the time RMS Queen Mary was ordered by Cunard, there was already a method for improving the turbine engines. You see, Queen Mary had four engines, each driving a propeller shaft, but within each engine were four ahead turbines. Two of them had reverse capabilities. The turbines were not directly connected to the propeller shaft, but rather, they spun the propeller shaft thanks to a single reduction gearbox. The large gear in the center is attached to the propeller shaft, and the four smaller gears at opposite ends were driven by the turbines. By making the turbine gears very small and the shaft gear extra large, it reduced the resistive force of the water and allowed the turbines to spin much faster, using their momentum and speed and turning that into power. When competing for the blue ribbon, Queen Mary produced a combined 200,000 shaft horsepower, far more than any other ship in the 1930s, and in some instances was able to get up to 212,000. Queen Mary won the blue ribbon from SS Normandy because she had raw power, limited only by the amount of steam that could be produced, whereas Normandy's propellers were attached to electric motors which had a limit to the amount of horsepower that could be put out. Normandy could produce a maximum of 160,000 shaft horsepower, still superior to most ships of her era, but just not enough to beat Queen Mary. But of course, we can't talk about the evolution of steam turbine technology on ocean liners without mentioning the very pinnacle of the technology. The SS United States took the blue ribbon from Queen Mary in 1952, averaging a speed of 35 knots, which was all thanks to her four double reduction geared turbines, operating at 925 psi of steam pressure and producing a combined 240,000 shaft horsepower. The United States still holds the blue ribbon and represents the very last word in the greatest achievement of steam power, and more specifically, marine steam turbines. Steam turbines continued to be used on merchant ships for many decades to come, but none were designed to compete for the ribbon. But now you can see why turbines succeeded the reciprocating engine, and how very influential they were to merchant shipping in the early 20th century. If you enjoyed this video, be sure to leave a like and subscribe for more videos about the age of steam.